Many, many thanks to Cheryl and to the band. And I also want to say thanks to Lynn Miller for stepping up and helping to lead this morning. She's doing a great job. And Sue Budenner is here. She was sitting, I think, right over here. And Sue, thank you so much for the video on Right Now Media. Appreciate that. There may be folks who watch this service online, who watch the video of the message. They're going to wonder, what is the preacher doing with one wet arm and one dry arm? And so I'm just going to acknowledge, wasn't it great to have Leo renew his baptismal covenant? Where's Leo? So there he is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We rejoice in that. 30 years ago, I had the privilege of baptizing our twins, daughter and son, as well as our niece, all in the same service. It was a jubilant day for our family, faith-filled, as we brought the children to the Lord, surrounded them with our prayers, and asked for God's blessing upon them. I took each child in my left arm, cradled them there, and then cupped my right hand and scooped up as much water as I could get into it. And then one by one, as with each one, I poured that over their forehead and spoke their full name and baptized them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And then with my forefinger, I marked the sign of the cross on their forehead, that they would be marked for Christ forever. As I said to Leo a moment ago. And then I recited 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. A verse that I have spoken many, many times. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. Baptized and beloved, each and every one of us. This is a Sunday where we read about the Lord's baptism, but also reflect on our own in its meaning. That baptism that we had with our children and our niece 30 years ago, we shared with an entire congregation, just like today. And it's sharing in a sacred act that is traceable all the way back to John the Baptist and Jesus at the River Jordan. Luke has the leanest description of that. It's only two verses, but let's read his description. Luke chapter 3, verses 21 and 22. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." Let's pray. God, we thank you for your baptism of your Son and how special that occasion must have been, but also how you must view the baptism of each of us as your children. So help us to contemplate that, to reflect on what that means, and open our hearts to your word and to your grace. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. By the way, before I go any further, I will say, if any of you have never been baptized and would like to be baptized, or if in some cases it's been a remote experience in your life and you would like to renew that covenant, please speak to me or one of the others on staff, and we'd like to make that happen. When all the people were baptized, that's the way the passage begins. Yes, it was a movement. It was a phenomenon. It would have gone viral on the internet. It was a big story. Crowds from all over the region descending into the Jordan River Valley, awaiting their turn with John. Now, he was something of a young eccentric, the son of a priest, Zechariah. But John preferred the wilderness to the temple where he might have served. He wore sackcloth instead of the fine robes that his family was accustomed to. He had an odd gluten-free diet of honey and locusts. I mean, John probably even liked kale. He attracted a band of followers who were known for their fasting. Of course, with a diet like that, I might fast too. They were known for fasting and praying. And his criticism, his prophetic tone could be severe, even harsh. But he inspired expectation. He was the voice crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord." There were some who even wondered, could he be the Messiah? And others just wanted him silenced or in prison. In fact, when John criticized the royal family, it cost him his freedom. It cost him he lost his head, literally. But before that happened, he was the go-to figure for repentance. And people from all over the area came to the Jordan looking for forgiveness, looking for cleansing and a new life, some way to start a new life. And one day, when his cousin Jesus showed up and wanted to be baptized, John demurred, he hesitated. In fact, Matthew gives us more detail on this. It says that John said, no, I shouldn't baptize you. You should be the one baptizing me. However, Jesus insisted, said, no, this is necessary to fulfill all righteousness. I am to be baptized. It was also a way in which he could identify with all the sinners, like you and me. And so he does. He proceeds to baptism. The Holy One was immersed by John. Not because Jesus needed to be purified, but as a way to foreshadow when he would actually die for all the sins of the world. And then he was raised with a splash of grace that rippled out and continues to ripple all the way to you and me. The ripples of grace continue. Jesus was baptized and he was praying. And it must have been an intense spiritual moment when the heaven was opened, we're told. All four Gospels reflect some awe or wonder at that moment. And all four Gospels report two heavenly arrivals, a dove and a voice. First, the Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus in the form of a dove. The image of a dove is worth a moment of our attention. This past week, I had close encounters with two distinctive birds. I was on the balcony doing some hammering on a project when all of a sudden I heard some other hammering. And sure enough, I looked up. About 15 feet above me on an oak branch was a pileated woodpecker hammering away. I ran in and grabbed my camera, ran back out, and he was pretty shy. He was eager to keep moving around that branch and find more insects. Although famous for their red crest, they're remarkably well-suited for their pounding work. The bill is a long, pointed, self-sharpening chisel. And it was amazing to watch all the bark and the wood flying off as he was doing his work. And their necks are extremely strong. They apparently can deliver 1,000 G force. Now, we can never come anything close to that. The woodpecker also has its built-in shock absorber system, so it can pound all day long without getting a headache. It wasn't a woodpecker that came down and lighted on Jesus when he was baptized. It wasn't a woodpecker. I was having breakfast then another day this week. when a red-shouldered hawk swooped down and landed on the roof of our front porch, less than 20 feet away from me. I eyed him, and he eyed me warily inside the window. He was watching me, so I didn't go to get my camera. In fact, the pictures I'll put up on the screen for you, these are pictures of a hawk that I took down in the Great Swamp National Park, or National Swamp Area, Cypress Swamp, near the Everglades. He perched there very patiently. He was intently watching for a careless squirrel or lizard or some other moving breakfast. And it was fascinating to watch his patience. And he stayed right there watching, checking me every once in a while. We made eye contact. And he would keep moving around. And it was fascinating. Finally, the yard waste truck that was going by scared him away. It was wonderful. And I realized that raptor is known well for its keen eyes, its curved beak, and its sharp talons. It's an instinctive hunter. It wasn't a hawk that flew down and landed on Jesus. It was a dove, also known as a pigeon. They're in the same family. So what's up with the dove? Why a dove? Well, in the law of Moses, you may know this, in the law of Moses, the only birds that are considered clean and acceptable or approved for sacrifice were doves, turtle doves or pigeons, the only ones that were considered acceptable for sacrifice. And you may remember that Noah, when he wanted to see if the waters were subsiding, he sent out a dove. And it was a dove that came back with the olive leaf. And the Hebrew name Jonah means dove. Jonah literally means dove. Jonah, who was sent on a mission to the despised city of Nineveh, and he tried to get out of it unsuccessfully. A dove conveys purity and it conveys hope, and it's someone on a mission or someone with an important message to deliver. And it's like that Holy Spirit comes down and lights on Jesus to signify the important mission that Jesus is sent to fulfill. And then came a voice from heaven. And that voice pronounced words you have already heard today. You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased. What a poignant, beautiful moment. A dozen years ago, Bobby and I delivered our younger son, Jordan, to college for the first time. And he was a freshman reporting for football camp. And so we helped him move things into his room. And then we went out to the store, remember, and bought him a rug and other assorted items that we as parents were sure that he needed to have. Parents kind of stuff. Before we left to drive 100 miles home, we pulled a desk chair into the middle of his room. His roommate hadn't arrived yet. We asked him to sit down there. And we spoke these words to him. You are our son, our beloved, with whom we are well pleased. And I reminded him, though he knew it, I reminded him that those words were connected to the baptism of Jesus and the start of Jesus' public ministry as a major crossing for Jesus when those words were spoken. Most of all, we just wanted him to hear that affirmation from us one more time. We prayed over him and for that significant crossing of his and also for us. Of course, he'd made many crossings before. It wasn't new or unprecedented. Some of his crossings were done literally, like this moment as a seven-year-old crossing a pine log bridge over a rushing stream in Colorado. This was near our primitive campsite in a national forest, not far from Aspen, Colorado. And Jordan, the campsite was probably just about 30 to 40 yards from the edge of the stream, the creek. It's the Maroon Creek coming out of the Maroon Bell. Some of you may know the area. And we were camped right here, and he kept looking at that. He kept, 7-year-old, he is bound to determine there's some time that he's going to do. So finally I said, all right, you're going to do this with supervision. I'm not sure Bobby was in favor of that mini adventure, given the speed of the current and the rocks down below. Leave it to me to sanction the crossing and to take a picture of it. And Jordan was very carefully deliberate. I mean, his balance, his nerve, his patience served him well when he was out there in the middle of it by himself. Yes, by the way, we named him Jordan after the river. We like the name, but the name also means the descender, or that which descends quickly. And the river Jordan descends very quickly through a steep valley. It goes down very, very quickly. And Jordan descended quickly as a twin brother arriving 4 minutes after his sister. He descended through the birth canal very quickly. It's a good thing he didn't descend quickly from that log bridge. He made it over and back and then a few more times. And it was just one of the many crossings that our children have made. And like the voice that came from heaven, we want them to know you are our child, our beloved, whom we approve. God models a way for us to communicate with our children and grandchildren and others who are in our sphere of influence. God gives us a way of affirming that, speaking that identity. It's a message of grace. It's how we're to understand the baptism of Jesus and our own baptism, our identity. It affirms that we are beloved children of God. We share that with Jesus. In fact, Jesus tells us that we are free to address God Almighty as Father, Abba, Daddy. He helps us to know that. And the approval also comes from God through Jesus. It's not that God is well pleased with everything we do all the time. That's never true for parents either, any of us, with our children. No. We don't have the same approval rating that Jesus does. But because of Jesus' sinless life and sacrificial death, and because of our baptism, God perceives us in a new and approved way. You and I pass any inspection because of Jesus. We're approved for the crossing. We are commissioned for whatever work God has us to do. My child, beloved, approved. My child, beloved, approved. My child, beloved, approved. Baptism signifies God's grace directed to each and every one of us, directed to us through Jesus Christ. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. We're forgiven and approved because of the cross of Jesus, our brother. And we live connected and we live accountable to God. That's what it means to be in a baptismal covenant, is to be connected and accountable to our Lord. It means that for all of us. 8 years ago, I was busy packing for a family trip to Florida. We were scheduled to leave 5:30 the next morning for a Thanksgiving visit to my parents who live in Leesburg. At 10:30 that night, I got a desperate phone call from dear friends and church members, and I dashed off to Children's Hospital about 20 minutes away. hurried through the lobby into the elevator and then up to the neonatal intensive care unit. Passed through a gauntlet of friends who were in the waiting area and in the hallways. They were praying for 9-day-old Gretchen, who was born prematurely and who only an hour or so before had taken a radical turn for the worst. I had ministry connections with four generations of that family, great-grandparents, grandparents, parents, and infant. Deep relationships. In fact, relationships with the families of both the father and the mother. As I approached the entry into the NICU, the neonatal intensive care unit, one of the hospital chaplains met me there and informed me that Gretchen had died just a few moments earlier. Everything possible had been done for her. She wasn't strong enough for this world. He said the family was still gathered in the room with her, not sure exactly what to do, taking turns holding her, all bundled up in blankets. Father and mother turned to me when I walked in the room, and their faces of anguish said it all without a word. The room overflowed with all four generations, and aunts and uncles and cousins, and I knew every one of them, sharing early moments of grief, still in shock. We'd had many happy times together. Now we were all wiping away tears, young and old, men and women, Presbyterian and Roman Catholic, emotional and stoic, and I'll tell you, we all melted together in that room. And Gretchen's father looked at me and he asked, "Would you still baptize her?" "Yes, Brian and Angela, I would do that. But you understand, we don't need to do that for Gretchen's sake. She's already well in God's keeping, safe and secure. There's nothing we need to do to seal her salvation. God's mercy already takes care of that." And they listened and nodded agreement. But they said, both of them, that they still wanted to give expression to their faith and giving their daughter over to new life in the Lord. It was important for them. The chaplain left and he quickly brought back what we needed for the baptism. And I began by sharing a few sentences of scripture and a brief prayer. Then I've done hundreds of baptisms over the years. I've administered hundreds of baptisms of all ages, but none quite like this one. And I addressed the questions to Brian and Angela, to the parents, that they could affirm their faith in Jesus Christ. And then I modified the questions just a little bit to fit the moment. Then with great tenderness, Angela handed to me her priceless and lifeless firstborn. And I cradled her tiny form in my arm, my left arm, and I cupped my right hand and dipped it into the bowl and took as much water as I could get. Pouring that over her forehead, I pronounced, "Gretchen Nicole, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." And with my forefinger, I made the sign of the cross on her forehead, and I marked her as Christ's own forever. Looking around the room at all the faces whom I knew, I affirmed, in life and in death, we belong to the Lord. And In him we do not perish, but we enter into a life that he has prepared. And Gretchen's eyes are already closed to this world, but opened to eternity. And then I spoke again, the words that are on the screen. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. And so we are. I cannot say the heavens opened up that day. We were deep inside a cavernous hospital. But I can tell you this, God came clearly and palpably and lovingly into that room as if the Spirit fluttered in with a message of comfort to those of us who were just embarking in a season of grief. Gretchen was baptized and beloved. And so are we all. Whether our earthly life is 9 days or 90 years, so are we all. You and I are God's children, beloved and approved. God is well pleased, not with everything we do, not because everything is right, but because God makes everything right in Jesus Christ. God is good. All the time. All the time. God is good. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for baptism. Thank you for words that you speak to Jesus and through Jesus to us. Because that grace is conveyed to us as well, that we are your children, your beloved, and approved because of your grace, because you've made everything right through Jesus Christ. Thank you for all that that means, and help us to live and flourish in the light of that truth. Thank you for promises made at the occasion of baptism. Sometimes we made the promises ourselves, or others made them for us, but help us to live them out, just as you make good on your promise for us, for life that is abundant and eternal. In the name of Jesus, who was baptized at the River Jordan, we pray. Amen.